Hello, and welcome to KDAB News, the almost monthly update for professionals working with Qt, C++, and 3D technologies. I'm Robert Brock, and in this edition, we have Qt DevCon postponed, Qt 6.2 and beyond interview with Maurice Galinowski, Qt Creator 5.0 released, KD Reports 2.0.0 ready for Qt 6, Tool of the Month, Programmer's Guide to C++ 20, and announcements. As you already might have noticed, we had to postpone Qt DevCon to June next year. The training day and conference program will stay mostly the same, but some changes might occur. You'll find more information about the new dates, tickets, and recurring updates on qtdevcon.com. We hope to see you in Berlin in June 2022. That said, it also means that one of the keynotes about Qt 6.2 and beyond couldn't be delivered, but there's good news. Maurice Galinowski from the Qt Company is here with me today to give you at least a quick overview about recent developments regarding Qt 6.2. Hi, Maurice. It's good to have you here.
Hi, Robert. Thanks for inviting me.
Of course, no problem. So what we hear is that Qt 6.2 is on track with alpha and beta releases. How is it coming along?
It's coming along very nicely and very smooth, to be honest. By the time of this recording, we will have the beta 4 being released, including all the API reviews, etc. So the next step for us then is to do the release candidate, which we're planning to have around mid of September. And if that is also going smooth, the plan is to have the final 6.2.0 then at the end of September, in worst case, beginning of October. But things are looking good for end of September.
It's a reward in itself when releases are on time. So nicely done for that. And what are the three or four most important changes you would highlight?
On a product that big, it's sometimes hard to focus on three or four. But I think overall the message is, because 6.2 is going to be the first LTS release, so the focus clearly has been on quality, also in respect of you are able to migrate over from Qt 5 to Qt 6 now. And maybe answering a bit longer that question, when we started with 6.0, we have been bringing in so many new innovations like the updated RHI, 2D, 3D capabilities, C++ 17 modernizations, etc. And we started with that essential core where we said, like, this is like what most applications and projects out there use from Qt, and then have been broadening the support to other modules. So that's called usually what we call inside the Qt company the feature parity aspect of that. And that process is now also finished with 6.2. So all of the features you have from Qt 5 are now also either one by one or in a derived way available in 6.2. But I guess if we're talking about content-wise and 6.2 specifically in that process, I think multimedia has gotten quite some awareness because we have been doing some rewriting in there. When it comes to bringing Qt and the web together, web engine is ported, but we also put significant effort into WebAssembly. We see a lot of traction coming in there. But also when it comes to the operating system, specifically desktop and mobile ones, Mac with the M1 architecture is clearly getting quite some attention these days. But also Windows on ARM seems to be coming up quite significantly right now. And on the mobile side, Android and iOS also got quite some love in there as well.
Wow, thanks. A really comprehensive answer that shows how much there is going on in the background. What would you recommend to people with a Qt 5 application wanting to port to Qt 6.2?
Right. The situation as such is that, first of all, I would recommend to go to the documentation. So each module in Qt itself has a porting guide, like how does the API change, signatures, etc. So that helps you from a, let's call it, passive approach. But also Qt itself, there's two options. One is to compile Qt 5 in a Qt 6 way, where we already knew which functions are going to be deprecated. So you can kind of start the migration while being on Qt 5. But also in addition to that, there's lots of articles from, well, you from KDAB, but also Basis.com, other partners who have been successfully porting their projects already towards Qt 6. In addition to that, we have been doing a webinar also covering all these aspects in a bit longer perspective. So there's quite some materials, and there's actually rather, from our perspective, smooth migration path to go from 5 to 6.
Great advice. We'll also add a link to the documentation, as that is indeed always a good place to start. Also, speaking of helping, you have a webinar coming up this month?
Yes, the 14th, that is basically about 5.15 and 6.2 to take these two releases in comparison. What are the changes overall in the Qt 6 story, but also how it behaves, like I mentioned previously, in regards of module and feature parity with Qt 5, going there a bit more into the detail generally.
So 5.15 to 6.2, September 14th, we'll link to that below. So is there anything else you would like to add? Anything coming up on the horizon?
Quite a lot of things, to be honest. Usually we say Qt 6 has a long, or will have a long lasting history, and 6.2 is a crucial point in there, as has been 6.0. I think when we're looking like where we are right now, where we're moving towards to, you will see lots of things we have been talking about earlier, like the property system is getting adoption. Most of you might remember the technical vision blog post by Lars Knoll, our CTO. Many of these things are coming in there, specifically also in the QML language, when we have been talking about static, strict, dynamic mode. How does it all fit together in going more towards compilable QML for performance reasons, speed ups, etc. But also moving a lot into the toolability aspect, QML lint, QML format, language server support for QML. Those are all important assets when to also help speeding up the development process in itself.
Technology never rests, and neither are you guys. Thanks for all the work you put into improving Qt, and thank you, Maurice, for the interview. See you at the webinar, and hope to see you at Qt DevCon in Berlin in June 2022 then.
Yeah, in German you say aufgeschoben is not aufgehoben. Delayed is not cancelled, so looking forward to that session.
That's true. Thank you very much.
Bye.
A few weeks ago, the first major version update of Qt Creator, namely version 5.0, was released. It comes with experimental support for ClangD as the backend for the C++ code model. This feature is optional and turned off by default. It replaces the libClang-based code model, building on the support for the language server protocol. Another experimental feature is some support for building and running applications in Docker containers. Further improvements have been made regarding editing, projects, and platforms. Read more in the release notes, linked below. The new version of KD Reports, a Qt library for generating printable and exportable reports from code and from XML descriptions, is ready for Qt 6. The latest release, 2.0.0, can be co-installed with Qt 5. Further, it abandoned QMake as a build system. Last but not least, Python bindings for KD Reports have been added. You can find more details about the release in the release notes and on GitHub. In our Tool of the Month section, I have, as the name will indicate, something very quick and simple. SimpleMail, created by our colleague Daniel Nicoletti, is a small library written in C++ for Qt 5 and Qt 6 that comes in handy when applications should send emails, be it MIME with text, HTML, attachments, inline files, etc., via SMTP. It's available under the GNU LGPL. As I said, quick and simple this time. Try it out via the link below. If you're a C++ programmer, it probably won't have escaped your attention that the C++ 20 standard has been released and is supported, in great part, by the most popular compilers. We're excited by this, not only because we love C++ and because many of us at KDAB our language standard wonks, but because it provides some of the most revolutionary changes to the language since the groundbreaking C++ 11 release. C++ 20 provides C++ with even more power and expressiveness and levels the playing field between this veteran workhorse language and the newer upstarts. KDAB's Giuseppe D'Angelo and Ivan Cukic have assembled a useful guide to the new standard that we have linked for you below. While C++ 20 contains dozens of improvements and fixes, they're focusing on the changes they think will make the biggest differences to the everyday C++ programmer. Of course, they will talk in detail about the biggest four improvements: concepts, coroutines, modules, and ranges. But we'll also share a couple of smaller changes that we think are interesting. Before we start with event news, I'd like to make a short note on KDAB's own account. We are looking for talented software engineers to join our team. So, if you have ever thought of applying at KDAB, now's a good moment. And if you haven't thought about it, you can still think about it now. You'll find more information about the desired skills on our website. And now, over to events. Wait, that's also me. On the 3rd and 4th of November, there will be an online edition of Qt-World Summit, which, by the way, KDAB is sponsoring as a gold sponsor. You can learn about the latest news on Qt technology, software tools, and features. There will be 4 real-life case studies, and probably the most important, a deep dive into Qt 6.2 with technical talks on cross-platform development, future of QML, the new multimedia and virtual reality features. Registration is free, so you can go check it out. Another event KDAB is sponsoring is CPPCon from the 24th to the 29th of October in Aurora, Colorado and online. Bjarne Strastrup will give the opening keynote on site. The full program will be announced shortly, so check it out on the website for updates and ticket offerings. And already at the end of September, from the 27th to the 30th, there will be the Embedded Linux Conference. This will be combined with the Open Source Summit in Seattle, which also offers virtual access. You can expect a broad variety of expert speakers, among them Linus Torvalds. Tickets are still available for on-site and virtual access at various price levels. Thank you for watching. Stay safe and feel free to share any feedback or questions below the video. I'll see you next time.